NATO Secretary General also assuring Ukraine supplying the country with weapons is on top of their priorities. NATO Chief Jens Stoltenberg asserts Russia winning the war should not be an option.
There is a full-fledged war going on in Europe, and there is no risk-free option, no risk-free option for NATO allies either. But the biggest risk is if President Putin wins. Because then the message is that when he uses military force, when he violates international law, when he invades a neighbor, then he gets what he, wants. And that's exactly why it is so important for NATO allies to support Ukraine.
U.S. President Joe Biden meanwhile vows unity from the alliance in the face of what he called Russian President Vladimir Putin's craven lust for power.
Our alliance remains a bulwark of global security and stability, as it's been for more than seven decades. NATO is stronger, more energized, and yes, more united than ever in its history. Indeed, more vital to our shared future. It didn't happen by accident. It wasn't inevitable. When Putin and his craven lust for land and power unleashed his brutal war on Ukraine, he was betting NATO would break apart. He was betting NATO would break. He thought our unity would shatter at the first testing. He thought democratic leaders would be weak, but he thought wrong.
Updates from the NATO summit in Lithuania. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky says his meeting with NATO leaders ended on a big and positive note, with the U.S. and other allies unveiling new security assurances for Kyiv. Zelensky also optimistic that Ukraine will be able to join the military alliance in the future.
We really got unity, and the leaders supported Ukraine. It was unambiguous that Ukraine will be in NATO. Speaking of when it will be, I'm confident of the support of the leaders from the speeches of each of the leaders today at our NATO-Ukraine meeting. I believe that we will be in NATO as soon as the security situation is stabilized. To put it in simple terms, the moment the war is over, Ukraine will definitely be invited to join NATO, and Ukraine will become a member of the alliance.
Ukraine has been pushing for a rapid NATO membership, but no clear timetable was established on when it can officially join the alliance. NATO members, though, vowed to continue supporting Kyiv and defend it from Russia's aggression.
We have delivered. Together with our G7 partners, we have agreed to provide the long-term bilateral security commitments that Ukraine needs. These commitments mark a new high point in international support for Ukraine. And I want to be clear, they are not a substitute for NATO membership. The summit communique echoes the UK's long-held position that Ukraine's future is in NATO. And we've taken a big step this week towards bringing Ukraine into the alliance.
China urging NATO to stop what it called groundless and provocative remarks against the country. See, NATO earlier issued a strongly worded communique saying that China is challenging the bloc's interests, security, and values with its ambitions and coercive policies. China firing back, saying NATO should stop distorting and smearing Beijing's image before the international stage. China also refusing to accept or recognize the 2016 arbitral win of the Philippines. That landmark victory invalidated China's expansive claims in the South China Sea, with the International Tribunal at The Hague upholding Manila's sovereign rights over the West Philippine Sea. Beijing now claims the ruling has been widely questioned by the international community, but Wednesday's show of support from diplomats on the 7th anniversary of the ruling says otherwise.
The United States believes that all countries, large and small, should play by the same rules. With the arbitral ruling, international law won out, protecting a nation's sovereign and economic rights.
We have to show that we have capabilities to protect our sovereignty and our national interests. And if like-minded countries come together to do that, of course the effect of it will be greater.
To further inform the public about Manila's arbitral victory over Beijing, the Foreign Affairs Department launched a microsite about the ruling. Now, this site's title, Not One Inch, was attributed to President Marcos's previous statement that the country won't lose an inch of its territory. The DFA says the microsite will provide a central resource for official information and positions on the award and its contributions to the rule of law and peaceful settlement of disputes through UNCLOS. A former Philippine Solicitor General, meanwhile, suggests another case may be filed against Beijing over its maritime dispute with Manila. Francis Havdeleza notes the Philippines had only filed for a declaration of rights and not of damages in its 2013 complaint. Now, Havdeleza says the Office of the Solicitor General can choose from a menu of cases it can still file against China. But he points out that immediate action ultimately lies with President Marcos.
Of course, we all have to remember that ultimately, the decision of how best to proceed or not to proceed will reside solely with our beloved president as the chief architect of our foreign policy. It is my hope, however, that on the 7th anniversary of our historic win, we pause and consider the lessons of our victory and be guided as we engage in spirited debate on how best to achieve the same patriotic goal.
Philippine senators slammed the seeming lack of control of Filipino shareholders and the National Grid Corporation of the Philippines. See, 60% of the NGCP is owned by Filipino businessmen, while the remaining 40% belongs to Chinese stakeholders. But the NGCP revealed its board cannot even convene and come up with a collective decision without a representative from China.
Majority kami, 60%, but I cannot make any decisions. For me, that's a de facto veto by the minority.
That's not
what is being contemplated by the Constitution. The Constitution gave us 60% so we can make decisions. My point is we're violating the Constitution because we cannot make a decision.
Filipinos can always be in control, management-wise, finance-wise, and the operations. But how can you be in control if you cannot call for a board meeting?
The scolding comes after the Energy Regulatory Commission earlier flagged NGCP for delays in the completion of power projects. Another senator, meanwhile, calls for higher taxes on the grid operator.
Pag-aralan natin, no, yung 3% franchise tax ng NGCP, pwede siguro natin taasan yun. Number 3, yung corporate income tax na rin. Baka pwede nating malaking makukuha natin dyan, Pondo. Pero ang laki ng makukuha natin kung taasan natin yung franchise tax at yung corporate income tax ng NGCP.